All right, the optimal angle has been achieved. What's up guys, it's Mario here, back with another video. And in this one, I wanted to do a quick Q&A with you guys. I basically went through a bunch of videos in the last couple of weeks. I went through the comment section. I looked at all the questions that you guys have been posting. I wanna thank you for that. There's some really amazing questions there in the comment section. And I wanted to answer most of that in one go. I looked at what is repeating itself through Facebook, Instagram, email, YouTube comments. There's a lot of stuff that kind of keeps getting asked all the time. So I wanted to just handle it in one video. So let's get into that. And I wanna start off this with the first question, which is actually one of the most recent ones, a really good question actually. And it's from Henry, and he said, "Hi Mario, can you do a video about how to auto-regulate on a diet or a bulk? I've been counting calories for a long time, but it's not possible to count calories forever." So the term auto-regulation, I mean, that's a very interesting term that you use it in this context of dieting or in the context of nutrition, because that's generally used for training purposes, right? We talk about auto-regulation when we're determining whether you need to increase your volume, intensity, frequency, how to manage that, decrease, deload, and all these other things. But it's a really cool term to use in, let's say, establishing your calories and how do you figure out that. Now, when we're talking about fat loss or, let's say, lean gaining in your context or even a bulk, there are certain things you want to look at, basically, aside from counting calories, that will determine whether you want to change your diet or not. I mean, counting calories itself, it's just kind of a security that you are hitting a certain amount that you set for yourself. But that doesn't mean that you shouldn't be measuring your progress. Actually, measuring your progress is even more important than what you're counting calories or whatever is happening in terms of your metrics, right? In terms of what you're aiming at. Because if the progress is not happening, you have to make changes. Now, if we're looking at fat loss, obviously measuring progress there, we'll be measuring number one, body weight, number two, some form of body fat estimation. You can just use raw caliper measurements. You can also use waist size as a tape measure. You can also use a whole bunch of other things. Maybe you have a scale that has a body fat percentage, which can also be used to, let's say, measure over time, and you can find some data to correlate there. And that's the kind of stuff that you're looking at. And let's say for fat loss, you don't even need to count calories. If the scale is going down, if the measurements are going down, if the strength in the gym is going up, don't even need to count calories. I mean, most people will spontaneously lose weight or lose fat if they're doing certain things such as dominantly having, let's say, a healthy, whole, unprocessed foods-based diet, if they're doing intermittent fasting, if they're training, let's say, 4 to 6 times a week, if they're really active in their lifestyle, they're gonna lose weight, right? They're gonna lose body fat. And for a lot of purposes there, until you, let's say, wanna reach that point where you're completely shredded, there's really no point in counting calories. I mean, of course, you wanna count calories if you are interested in full control, but I mean, if you hate counting calories, as you say that for you, it's not sustainable, you don't need to do that. You can get fairly lean without counting calories. Now, on a lean gaining, on a bulk kind of diet, that's where getting those measurements is a little bit more tricky. And that's why I would recommend having some kind of calorie control, just to make sure that you're not overshooting your intake. And when we're talking about intake in general, that's basically determined on your progress. How much are you gaining? Obviously, your strength is supposed to go up on a lean gaining diet, but also certain metrics are supposed to go up. What is your monthly rate of weight gain, right? It should be somewhere between, I'd say, 0.5% to 1.5%, depending on your training age, right? The less training age you have, the more potential you have to build muscle. So that's something to look at. Also, you can look at tape measure. You can measure your thighs, your bicep, your chest, and you can see whether those are increasing in size. Also, on a lean bulk diet, where calorie control is really necessary, is to make sure that you're not overshooting calories, because nutrition is a permission for you to grow, as Eric Helms says, right? Once you have enough nutrients, I mean, looking at what's happening in your body, if you have enough to build muscle, any extra will get stored as fat. It has nowhere else to go. So you want to make sure that you're controlling the rate of fat gain. So you don't necessarily even need to count calories as much if you have a really nice habitual intake and you know approximately what you're eating. and you're at the same time measuring the scale to make sure that the weight is not shooting up very fast, but also you're doing, let's say, raw caliper measurement of certain points on your body. Let's say your abdominal point would be a really good reference. So you can measure that and see whether the fat is getting stored, whether that metric is going up really fast. If it is, then you probably want to reduce your intake. So those are some of the things to look for. And I like to use the term here, autoregulation. I mean, I like that you use that term because it's really something that is gonna be changing over time as well, right? What is your intake right now for a lean gaining phase probably is not gonna be the same in a year. So it's important to look at that feedback that you're getting with your metrics to be able to assess that over time and then at the same time being able to make adjustments because it's really about adjustments. Fat loss and lean gaining is about adjustments. In terms of fat loss, we know that the body adapts, right? For every a couple of pounds you lose, you gotta keep cutting calories, right? Or you gotta keep increasing your activity. Something has to be done to kind of nudge that caloric balance into a negative state, into a deficit, for you to keep that rate of fat loss that is kind of optimal between, let's say, 0.5% to 1.5% of fat loss per week, or weight loss per week. We'll assume that most of that is fat if you're training, if you're having your sleep in order, if your nutrition is on point with a sufficient amount of protein, that should be fine, right? Now, again, this is a question of your individual response as well, and that's the final thing I'm gonna say here is that certain individuals might find that they don't need to make that many adjustments when we're talking about a lean gaining phase or let's say even a fat loss phase. Their metabolism isn't as adaptive, so to say. On other cases, there's individuals that have to really undercut calories quite frequently in order to keep that rate of fat loss going, and that's just the way it is. So you wanna see what is happening with you right now. You wanna see what kind of metabolism you have at this time. Maybe in a couple of years, it's gonna be different, right? So see how your body is responding and adapt and basically adjust from there. Now, second question here, question that I actually get a lot, and this is from Gabriel, and he's saying, hey Mario, how did you learn English so well? Any tips for people who don't speak the language? Because sometimes it can be hard to be doing all these things, especially social skills if you live in another country and don't speak the language. Now, this is a really good question. And any question, I mean, asking about a specific skill set, you have to put it in the right perspective. It is about practice, right? 80-90% of improvement will come from deliberate practice. And when it comes to languages, that's actually one of the easiest things to practice. And let's say you're starting at ground zero, starting from scratch, you have no idea about English. I would say that that's number one, a pretty rare case that you don't know a single word in English because you just wrote this comment in English. So I'm assuming that you're not, you think you don't know the language, but you know a lot more than you think. So it's probably an issue of a little bit of self-efficacy as well. A little bit of, let's say you being inhibited because you are not confident in your skills yet. I would assume that even if you have a basic kind of skill set in terms of English, you can still reach out to people and talk to them, at least some basic conversation, which doesn't even have to be done in person. This can be done online, joining certain Facebook groups and commenting on people's posts, posting on YouTube as you just did in the comment section. I mean, these are also places where you can practice. I mean, I learned my English through, number one, with gaming, just watching movies, watching anime, watching other cartoons as I was a little kid. Just when I was speaking to other people, as when I was, let's say, playing World of Warcraft, we would have this crazy old app, Ventrilo, I don't even know if it's still active. And we would just talk when we were doing certain things, right? And World of Warcraft is a lot about grinding, so you're spending a lot of time in the game, and you get bored a little bit, so you gotta talk with some people to make it interesting, right? So that's what we did, and that's where I practiced my English. And my English was actually not good for years, right? I mean, it took me years to be fluent. And even now, when you hear me talk, I'm gonna make a lot of mistakes. People who are native English speakers, they will notice that I make a lot of grammar mistakes, especially when I'm tired. I've noticed that when my brain gets tired at the end of the day, when I'm depleted, when I work really hard, I start making a lot of mistakes, especially when I start talking really fast, which a lot of people don't realize. If you're not a native speaker, you're gonna be very impressed because, oh, he's speaking really fast, so he must know what he's talking about. Well, not really, right? I make a lot of mistakes. But still, with a lot of practice, I mean, just simply applying myself through making this a priority, right? That's the first thing. You wanna make it a priority, and knowing English really opens up a lot of doors in your life. You can start reading more complicated books. You can start talking to people all around the world. I mean, English is pretty much a universal language right now. Number three, you basically have access to all the knowledge in the world. If you know English, right, that's basically everything in the world that is valuable right now in terms of knowledge. You can find in some form in English. So that's why I would recommend like digging into books, into audiobooks, into podcasts, into videos. As much as you can surround yourself with your environment, with English, the faster you're gonna improve. Moving to a country for a couple of months, let's say moving to Canada or United States or the UK or a place where there's a lot of English speakers and let's say a small community, even here when I'm in Spain, I have a community of my friends who all speak English. So, I mean, I am listening to Spanish a little bit, but most of the time I'm speaking English and I'm hearing English, which helps a lot. Now, making videos also helps a lot. So there's definitely nothing wrong with trying to blog and vlog in English, right? So you can just vlog in English every day, right? Just make your own channel, you know, you do it for fun. You don't really need to do it for any kind of monetary purposes, right? You can start your own blog with writing certain things in English. That helps a lot. I started like that as well. Before I was confident in what I could say, I basically started writing and that helped a lot. So there's many things. I mean, the first I would say is really have some kind of daily practice of English and try to scale that to surround yourself as much as possible with the language, and you're gonna be improving fast, right? So think of it as another skill set as anything else. It requires hours and hours and hours of practice, but you get good really fast if you apply yourself. Now, third question here, this one is from Instagram. Hey Mario, I'm starting to bulk today. What are good foods to bulk? Got some pure chocolate today and also heard from you that fat fish is nice. Now, there's number one, there's really no like ultimate food that is gonna build muscle, right? I mean, that's what protein is for. Once you get the amount of protein per day, that's basically building blocks, and you have calories, which is the sufficient amount of energy. There is something, the requirement there in order for you to build muscle. Now, what are some of my favorite foods for bulking? I kind of made a couple of statements similar to saying that basically the difference between my maintenance and my cut and my bulk is simply adding more dark chocolate. And that is somewhat true. That is very, very true, because most of my calories, if I look at my day, I'm gonna go through at least one chocolate bar, which is gonna be about 500 to 600 calories. I'm also gonna go for fattier fish compared to my fat loss phase. That's kind of the difference. I'm also gonna go for, let's say, full fat cottage cheese. I'm not gonna try to pick the low fat version, because my fat loss diet is kind of a lower fat, higher carb, moderate protein amount diet, while my gaining diet is more like high fat, moderate carbs, and kind of low to moderate protein. I don't go super high on protein, right? I'm kind of more looking at what Menno Helmsmans is advocating from Bayesian bodybuilding. So my protein intake is actually not that high. I'm getting about 140, 150 grams a day, which some bodybuilders, I mean, are getting 240, 250. It's kind of a different philosophy. Of course, there's a middle ground there as well, which I followed a long time. Now, once you get that, it's just a matter of what is the most convenient way to get your calories in. And for me personally, I find that higher fat diets, not just that I feel better when I consume a larger amount of fat, but I also find it much more convenient to get the calories, because it is an issue. I mean, if you're eating just 2-3 meals a day, if you have to eat 3,000 calories, those are huge meals. And if you try to get them from bland foods, and if there's not a lot of variety in your diet, you're gonna have a very hard time being consistent. And I mean, most people fail to build muscle because they're not consistent with their calorie intake. A lot of guys fail with that because they're not looking at how do I make this calorie intake something that's gonna happen on a daily basis, because every training day, at least, you have to have that higher intake, depending on how is your setup. Maybe you have some kind of calorie cycling setup, or just eating less on those non-training days and eating more on training days. So again, there can be a really big difference. So if you're a guy who's eating, let's say, between 2700 calories and let's say 4,000 calories, I mean, all those intakes will require a little bit of higher fat. And I would say after you get a pretty decent amount of carbohydrates, somewhere between, let's say, 300 to 400 grams a day, might as well put everything else into fat. And you're gonna notice that it's much easier. I mean, fat is much more calorie dense. Food is much more tastier, which makes it a lot easier for you to consume. And also, I mean, fat is very, very healthy. I mean, you have a lot of good, healthy source of fat. Some of my favorite additions to my diet right now are avocados, as I said, full fat cheeses, some fattier fish. I really love salmon. It's actually one of my favorite foods. And I just told you two of my favorite foods, dark chocolate and salmon. You have dark chocolate there. You have pumpkin seeds. You have, let's say, a variety of nuts. You have walnuts. You have almonds, which are really cool. You have peanut butter if you can tolerate that without going off the rails, which I can't. If it's in the house, I'm going to overeat it very, very fast. So I can't do peanut butter, but a lot of people swear by that. There's a lot of other sources. I mean, liquid calories are a really good source for fast calories as well. I mean, if you go for, I like fermented dairy, for example, kefir. It's one of my favorite sources of calories when I'm on a lean gaining diet, because I can just easily just drink a bunch of those, a couple of cups throughout the day, and I'm gonna get some really good nutrition. So it's really about making it very convenient for yourself and finding the foods that you like to enjoy that are much more calorie dense, which also makes that a little bit more interesting. Now the next question here, is it possible to intuitively eat an intermittent fast? This is a question from YouTube. Now, intuitive eating, what is that? Well, basically not tracking calories. That's what I classify as intuitive eating. It's basically listening to your body. And depends on your goal, right? You can certainly intuitively eat an intermittently fast if you have years of experience with tracking your diet. So you kind of have that developed intuition. I kind of have a little bit of a problem with people saying that you can just listen to your body. You know, if we just look at how that works in practice, and we can look at standard American diet, everybody's listening to their body, and we have 2/3 of people overweight, right? Everybody's listening to your body. But if you have a tub of peanut butter next to you, your body is gonna tell you to eat it, right? It's not gonna be enough to just feel full. No, it's just gonna be eating more than you need. And same for chocolate, same for other sweets, same for highly palatable foods, where your wiring, your current brain that you have isn't adapted to live in the environment that is today, right? The food environment today, where you have 40,000 different food choices and even more in just a basic supermarket, and a lot of those foods contain more calories than a hunter-gatherer could ever find in his whole life. And we still carry that same brain, right? Our brain still responds to that same good old formula. You know, how can I maximize the amount of calories to minimize the amount of effort while I'm getting those calories? You know, that's kind of like calorie per kind of unit of effort. And that's how your brain works. And if it has a bunch of highly palatable foods, very high calorie density, you cannot intuitively eat in that kind of environment. So I have that kind of problem a little bit of intuitive eating. I know it's a little bit of a tangent. Now, intermittent fasting, the power of that, it really comes down to the fact that it's gonna limit that intake naturally for a lot of people, right? So a lot of people will eat less, and they're gonna be able to control their calorie intake pretty well while doing some form of fasting, because they have a tighter eating window, which allows them to just maintain certain kind of control over their intake, which is quite hard in today's environment. Plus, it can help with feeling less hungry throughout the day, which also helps with a lot of people's kind of appetite for sweets or cravings or other stuff, because at least from my experience, and look at the data and look at my clients, I can see that a lot of them have managed to get out of the snacking habit because of intermittent fasting, because they have that eating window of, let's say, 6 to 10 hours, average 8 hours, and outside of that, there's no food. So it really kind of kicks that bad habit of snacking out, and then allows you to really have those solid meals, to enjoy the food, and even have 2-3 big meals on a diet, which is quite rare, right, on a fat loss diet, because your calories now are lower, but still, because you just split them in two meals, you can have two bigger meals, which is very satisfying, and you get much more satiety than from eating, let's say, 5-6 small snacks throughout the day, where you just burn through your calories and you never really get that feeling of fullness. And I mean, intuitive eating, intermittent fasting kind of goes hand in hand. I would say I'm a proponent of intuitive eating, but as a kind of a next step after you learn how to count your calories, at least for a couple of weeks, after you learn how to hit your macros after a few weeks of doing that, that's what I would recommend. I would not recommend just trying to wing it as the first step toward building a healthy lifestyle, as the first step toward learning about nutrition. Because that's kind of setting yourself up for failure because you have basically no idea about portion size. I remember before I thought like a slice of pizza was 100 calories, you know, and then I put it in my fitness pal and was like 2000, the whole pizza and the slice was like 600, right? It doesn't make sense. And that's something that I see a lot of people fail at, is they just cannot recognize calories on those sauces, on ketchup, on mayonnaise, on stuff that you add into your food, like cooking oil. I mean, a lot of salad dressings and things like that. It's just our brains aren't equipped to measure calories. Our brains don't have that security limit where it's saying, okay, that's over your limit right now. You cannot eat more because you're going to have health consequences. It doesn't make sense logically from an evolutionary standpoint that we should be limited in calories. In nature, you would never be surrounded with so many calories that would actually put you in danger, right? I mean, that's why we kind of had to engineer all this environment with industrial revolution last 150 years. Now we're in danger. But throughout the whole evolutionary process, we were never in danger of overeating. There's really no chance of you to get that many calories in nature. So a couple of, points here, but keep in mind, learn macros, learn calories, and then if you want to transition to intuitively consuming those, even tracking maybe once or twice a week, that's totally fine. Last question here, I think, let me just take a look. Actually, last two questions. Let's see here. Calorie counting is bullshit. You should know what you're eating and should be able to do a guess. You need to have faith on your workout and food. Trust is key. It's not overnight process. I mean, goes hand in hand with this question. Intuition is developed. If someone says, I mean, I see a lot of Instagram food babes and whatever the hell they're saying, oh yeah, you can just listen to your body. Trust the process. Look, if I listen to my body, I'm gonna be 300 pounds. I cannot listen to my body because my body is telling me to eat, especially if I'm in a low body fat percentage. So I have to have some kind of restriction, some kind of control. That's what fat loss is about. It is about some restriction. In today's environment, there has to be some form of control. You will go off the rails very, very easily if you're not controlling yourself. That's just an illusion and a marketing trick that these food babes and all these guys are getting you to buy in and spend money on their programs because they're telling you that you can get the easy way out, right? You don't have to track, man. You don't have to count calories. You don't have to do anything. It's just gonna magically happen. Your body knows how to get shredded. Well, here's a spoiler, right? Your body doesn't wanna get shredded. What your body wants is food. It wants to eat. Right? There's obviously some thermostat there that is gonna prevent you from overeating if you eat mainly whole, healthy, unprocessed foods and if you kind of keep an eye on calories. But if you're buying into the ad, which is saying you can eat all your favorite foods and you can just intuitively do that, that is a bunch of nonsense. You will just get fat. You will not be able to control your intake. Most likely, this for the vast majority of people is not going to work. If you're that outlier, there's obviously outliers who just burn off everything. They just eat french fries every day and drink a bottle of Coca-Cola. That's totally fine if you're that one of those people who have a very high level of non-exercise activity. They're just basically fidgeting off 2,000 calories. But if you're just an average person like myself with average genetics, you're going to get fat really fast if you don't have some form of restriction. And if you want to stay really lean, because when you're that lean, your body actually wants to regain some body fat. If you're at, let's say, that level below 10% body fat, where your appetite just goes through the roof. And I mean, again, I'm not gonna hammer and rant too much on this. I think you guys got the point. Next question from Petrus. Mario, do you have any tips about strength training frequency when on a cut? This is a really good question. Actually, I get this question a lot. How do you change your training when you're in a cut versus, let's say, in a maintenance slash lean gaining phase, right? Whatever phase you're in. And I'm kind of the opinion of the school that your training shouldn't change that much. Recovery does reduce on a cut, on a deep, like let's say when you're in the final couple of weeks on let's say before you get stage lean, then you might be concerned with recovery a little bit. But I think people are often kind of jumping to conclusions beforehand and they're reducing their training volume and really cutting down training volume as kind of a proactive approach to make sure that they're not getting overtrained. And it kind of doesn't sound like a good option to me, because you're missing out on gains. Because what I've seen is that if you keep... All right, we're back. Camera died, a battery was completely empty. So as I was saying there, the question is really, should you proactively adjust your training volume / frequency when you're in a cut? Should you try to prevent overtraining? And that's something I kind of disagree with a lot of coaches out there, that they're gonna act automatically cut out the volume because someone is in a cut. Well, from what I've seen is a lot of lifters, especially if you're, let's say, a novice or early intermediate or even an intermediate, you're still gonna make a lot of gains in the first part of that cut, or even in, let's say, 2/3 of the cut, you're still making great strength gains, you're making muscle gains. There's really no need for any kind of proactive reduction of volume. And I would look for signs before I would make these kind of decisions. Signs such as overtraining, let's say you're hitting plateaus in strength levels, you're not able to progress, that might be a sign that you're training too much. And this question was very specific, I mean, from Petros on strength training frequency. And we know, judging from the research right now, that I'd say training a body part 2 to 3 times per week seems to work really well. And for strength training, I mean, specifically for powerlifting, squatting seems to respond really well to an increased frequency. So I would squat, let's say, 2 to 4 times a week. Benching, let's say, 2 to 3 times per week. Deadlifting, let's say, once or twice a week seems to be pretty good as well. On a cut, seems to work. It depends, again, on your individual recoverable maximum amount of recoverable volume and how much you can tolerate. Again, I wouldn't try to calibrate before I actually do it, so I would look into how your body is responding and then adjust from there. Final question is something that is kind of a question that I get a lot, is here from Soccer Perfection. You live a pretty badass life, bro. What's your secret to success? Reading books or just lucky? So, I mean, number one, I don't even know if this question is legit or if it's just a troll. And I do get a variation of a similar question every single month, is, let's say, what's the secret to success? And there's really no secret. And that's something that I want to point out first here, is that it's like reading books are just lucky. I mean, can you read your way to success? You cannot do anything with just reading. Reading books, it's simply when you're already taking action, is something to give you an extra idea or maybe help you get more motivated to take better action or get an idea how to improve your taking of action. But taking of action is the necessity, it's the requirement, it's the building block of success, if you want to call it like that. Taking action is absolutely necessary. So working every single day for hours and hours and hours and hours after everybody else has stopped working. So I'm already assuming that you're doing 8 hours, but then the question is, how much more are you doing? Because if you wanna be successful in a field such as health and fitness, you better be ready to work. I mean, this is one of the most competitive, if not the most competitive niche out there. And you cannot distinguish yourself if you're not putting out an insane amount of content, an insane amount of work, and not just that, but you have to care about people legit. And that's something that it's really hard to measure. I mean, how do you measure caring? And if you don't care about people, health, and pretty much no niche is for you, right? If you're just looking at profit, or if you're just looking at, I wanna live a badass lifestyle, that's not gonna cut it, man. I mean, you have to legit care about other people getting results more than you care about yourself getting results, and also about your own health. You think making videos every single day is healthy? Hell no, dude. Like, it's far from what optimal health is, because you're putting so much pressure and stress on yourself. There's that sacrifice that a lot of people don't see. And the assumption a lot of people make, I mean, I'm gonna just address the just lucky part, is that success is random, right? If I just wait enough, you know, opportunities will show, or it's just gonna magically happen and some kind of random thing will occur that's gonna lead me there. And we know for a fact that it's not gonna randomly happen. Similarly, you will not randomly get jacked in the gym, right? You're not gonna randomly increase your squat or your bench press past a certain level. Maybe as a novice, you're gonna randomly make some gains in the gym, but if you're looking to actually become successful and let's say become financially free and make this, live a certain lifestyle, it's not gonna randomly happen. It's gonna be a plan and a lot of execution, a lot of execution, hours and hours and hours and hours and hours that nobody sees but you. It's the time when nobody's looking. That's when most of your work is going to be done. It's going to be boring work. It's going to be work that you don't get inspired to do. It's going to be those meaningless tasks that you don't even know make any difference, right? You don't even know, and you can't even measure whether that's making any difference, and you're just running on pure belief, right? You're running on pure belief that what you're doing is going to make difference. That's it, right? There's no feedback for years, right? That's the reality of it. You get no feedback. You get nobody to pat you on the back and say, oh yeah, you're gonna make it. No, the reality is that you're gonna be on your own. You're gonna put in effort, and not only will you not get anybody to support you, but probably you're gonna get people doubting your ability. You're gonna get a lot of hate. You're gonna get a lot of stuff because you're going against the norm, right? You're trying to achieve something that other people aren't achieving, and it's not a part of the normal, what they assume is the normal life. And that's something you have to be able to deal with. You're gonna change friends, you're gonna get into fights, you're gonna, maybe, I don't mean physical, I mean fights, I mean just verbal discussions with people. You're gonna get annoyed, you're gonna have to cut out certain things from your life, you're gonna have to sacrifice certain things that you really enjoy, even certain people out of your life, you're gonna have to eliminate certain habits. A lot of it is about saying no as much as it is about saying yes. You actually say yes only to a few things, but you have to say no to a lot of things. Because at the end of the day, what your success is really a daily practice of a couple of small habits. That's what it's gonna be. And you saying no every day to this entire planet trying to distract you. That's basically what it's gonna come down to, is you executing your purposeful plan while you're saying no to everything else. And every day you say yes to that other crap, you're not gonna have time to work on your own purpose. That's what it's coming down to. And how many days can you actually have that control? How many days can you stay committed to your goal? And that's pretty much, not just when it comes to business, but that's coming down to fat loss, that's coming down to building muscle. It's how many times you have to say to your friend, hey, I'm not gonna have that pizza. Hey, I'm not gonna go to the movies with you, I have to go to the gym. Hey, I can't do this today because I have something else. Because you already have your agenda. Being successful is having your own agenda and executing that agenda and being very, very protective over your own time. Because your time is very, very scarce. You realize how little time you have, and you're looking at maximizing the value, so you actually start valuing your own time more. And that's one big reason why some people are really hard to get a hold of, because they just don't have the time, right? If you don't have an enormous amount of value to bring, or if you don't have, say, some kind of angle that you can kind of work together to produce more value, people don't have a lot of time for that. That's like kind of the fun time, but that's not a lot of time, right? Fun time is like 5% of it. 95% of it is working, grinding, really going through a lot of failure until you get to where you need to go. I mean, I know it's a little bit of a silly question. As I said, I don't know if this is a troll or what it is, but I mean, I guess there's some luck to it, right? There's always some luck, but luck will not, I mean, luck is not the determining factor of your success. There's going to be lucky opportunities all the time, but if you're not ready for them, if you're not applying yourself and taking action every single day, that's totally useless. I mean, everybody's lucky. Everybody has some kind of opportunity thrown at them if they're working. But if you're not working, I can throw all these kind of opportunities at you. You're not gonna be able to take advantage of them. So luck is definitely an ingredient that kind of comes over time. Everybody gets a little bit of luck every now and then. Someone gets a lot more. But again, you wanna focus on things that you can control. Luck, you can't control. And if you get some, pretty cool for you, bro. But for most of us, I mean, we get shit luck, right? We just have to put in the work and hope for the best. So that's kind of the last question here. I want to thank you guys for watching the Q&A. Hope you enjoyed. Let me know in the comments below what do you think about the format, as well as, of course, comments. Put in the questions below for the next Q&A, and I'm looking forward to doing these a little bit more frequently. As I said, I mean, it's pretty unprepared content, so I just look through the questions and just answer them. I hope you guys got a value out of this. Aside from that, make sure that like button below, support the channel. It really helps a lot when I see those thumbs up go up. It really helps a lot with YouTube, as well as hit that subscribe button below if you haven't already, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.